It began with three ways to use focus, and with them, three videos were made. Pyromancy, sorcery, miracles. But they were all deceived, for another video was made. In the land of Lothric. Too much? Too much, yeah. Ah, I blew it. Dark Souls 3 with only weapon art. Roll the intro, roll the intro. I chose the knight, because the longsword is great and the armor is fine. In this video I'll only be able to deal damage with weapon arts, if it wasn't obvious. Oh, and it's an all bosses run, DLCs included. As you can see, this weapon art puts you into a stance where you can use two different attacks. They deal the same damage and consume the same focus, but one is faster and the other is a charge. With this weapon we can use the weapon art without focus, but it is half damage and costs a lot more stamina, so it's not ideal. This is the tutorial boss, so it's not hard at all. We just have to get the sword art attack's timings right, because they are really slower than a normal attack, and we can't chain them properly. But it's still the tutorial boss. The high wall of Lothric is easy as always, and you may wonder why I'm not going to take the deep axe we can find. That's because the axe's weapon art is simply a shout that boosts your attack, and yes, it does unlock a special moveset for the strong attack, but I didn't consider it a weapon art. It's debatable, so I chose the more restrictive option. In the meantime, we saved Greyrat and started the fight against Vort. We still have a few Estus flasks, so I think it's best to use them in the second part of the fight. Here we can clearly see that when we run out of focus we deal a really low amount of damage. And I know it seems strange since it's the first proper boss, but it's actually quite hard. Our attacks are almost as slow as casting a spell, but we have to be at melee range, and we always get staggered when we attack without focus. That said, we managed to win. We reach Undead Settlement, where we can find Yoel and advance Greyrat's quest. For now we can ignore the boss of this area, and we go straight to the Road of Sacrifices, meeting Sigvard along the way. We defeat a demon with him, but this time his quest won't come to his natural end. We proceed in the Road of Sacrifices, nothing interesting there, and here we can find the Grass Crash Shield, our trusty companion. And after we make the two warriors jump down the stairs, we can find enough materials in Farron Keep to have a +3 sword. Also, we take the great sword, we'll need it later. For now, though, we proceed in the other direction and fight the Crystal Sage. Being able to fight it with an actual weapon is refreshing for once. And yes, our attacks are slow and we can be hit pretty hard. But we can stagger him repeatedly if you get the right timing, and now we have enough ashen estus flasks to always have focus. We did enough damage to afford ignoring the clones and going straight for the true sage. And sometimes a rogue soul spear can kill us, but this boss is weak to physical damage, so it should be pretty easy. We arrive at the Cathedral of the Deep, and here we basically have to dodge attacks and run around until we unlock all the shortcuts. There isn't much else to do, so we can fight the boss. This fight had me sweating, because I can't backstab them since it isn't a weapon art. And after some attempts I started using the greatsword. With its weapon art I send the deacons flying in a pretty big area in front of me. I wouldn't say this trivializes the fight, since we still have to manage our resources well, because they can heal the boss and we can get stunlocked orcs to death. But it makes it really easier. Plus, I can say great sword goes spinny, so it's good. Deacons defeated, we proceed along the other way, and after zapping out the flames we can fight the Beast Watchers. I had some problems here. At first I went in with the great sword to try to knock them down, but it's too slow so I basically never hit them. Then I decided to try with my trusty longsword, but I can't backstab or parry them and my attacks are still slow, so I take a lot of cheap damage. I didn't know what to do, so I went and killed the demon in the meantime, and I even tried to use the dark hand on them, since they look humanoid enough, but it doesn't work. At that point I realized that my build was garbage, so I had to respec, and from now on I will only level up health and stamina. Thank you, Slug Waifu. Raw sword in hand, I went to beat up the Watchers. This fight is mostly a waiting game, and if you play aggressively like me, it can become quite annoying. In phase 1 we are only a tad slower than him, so we have to dodge some attacks, but all in all we can get in with a lot of damage with overall low risk. The second phase is definitely harder, because now his attacks have flames following them, meaning that if we try to get in like we did before we will get staggered by the flames. This means that we have to walk away from him and only get in after jumps, rolls or charge attacks, and we'll do it mostly with our own charge attack. It's not that hard, but you need some patience. Now we can get the most important ring for this run. We just have to offer the cinders of the Abyss Watchers to the throne, and the Crestfallen Knight will give us the Farron ring, that reduces the focus consumption when you use weapon arts. It's basically tailored for us. We can jump down the catacombs, nothing useful here, and after cutting down the bridge we venture into the Smoldering Lake, where we can get enough materials to upgrade our weapon to +7, if we trade a black bomb to the crows. We just had a pretty big power spike, so we can go and fight the old Demon King. This boss is not very hard, his attacks are even slower than ours, so we just have to dodge one and then we can get in easily. When he starts using his stuff, either summoning meteors or flame circles, we can run away just to be safe, and the fact that I have a huge health pool helps, because if he can kill you in one hit, you're going to have a bad time. I almost ran out of resources, but when he falls down, we can pierce his heart and proceed. Next in line is Walnir, but we just have to hit his bracelets a couple of times, there is basically no danger aside from death by boredom. Now I need to do some weed control. We have to kill the curse-rotted greatwood because it's a boss and we want the transposing kiln, and this seemed a time as good as any. It's an early game boss, so the hardest part of the fight is actually managing to hit him when he sucks around the air without having to wait for him to fall down, but the charge attack has good reach. Now we have another damage upgrade. Since our weapon is raw, we can use resins on it, and obviously we want them to be an element the boss we are fighting is weak to. This is why I had to buy the tower key, meat patches, and buy the human pine resin from him. The Dancer of the Boreal Valley, our next opponent, is weak to dark damage, and we are not actually meant to fight her now, so we need all the help we can find. All in all, the fight isn't that bad. We don't deal a lot of damage, but her attacks are pretty easy to dodge, and she has long waiting times between attacks. The second phase is a bit harder, also because my frames keep dropping when I'm near her. But if we don't get cornered and we play carefully, it's not hard at all. And with a comfortable amount of HP, I defeat her in the first try. Beating this boss now helps out a lot, because now we can easily get Titanite chunks, so after we run around Lothric Castle for a bit, we have a +9 weapon, no sweat. And you know what else helps out? Subscribing to the channel. This means that we can hop into the DLC, ignore all the enemies, and after a strange tree and a long ladder we find a Titanite slab, so our weapon is maxed out. In the meantime, we buy the composite bow, a surprise tool that will help us later. For now, we proceed into the eerie hill of the Boreal Valley, running around trying not to sleep in the icy streets. As always, we don't engage in combat with mobs and instead we simply go into the fight with the boss, and in this case, it's Pontiff Sullivan. He has long, relentless combos where we have almost no opening to attack due to our slow animations, and he sometimes mixes them up and manages to hit us even when we are facing his back. Thankfully, our equipment is way stronger than it should be for this area, so when we actually hit him, we deal a good amount of damage. In phase 2 he summons a clone, and this time we aren't able to one-shot kill it, so we have to actually play this part of the fight. I'm not sure how many people know this, but they do the same attacks, just with a bit of delay between the real Pontiff and the clone, so we have less time to deal damage, but we can easily predict what's going to happen. I had to pop an ember in the middle of the fight to heal, but after the clone falls, all hope is lost for the Pontiff, and we defeat him by stabbing his heart. Now we can run all the way up to Enorlondo and fight Aldrich, Devourer of Gods. I decided to try and attack mostly his human part, because it's a little bit riskier but we deal more damage to him. His attacks are annoying if he stays far away, but as long as we are close to him he will do slow swipes that deal a ton of damage but are easy to dodge. Most of the damage I take is because I'm greedy and I decide to hit him one more time, taking his teleport attack right in the face, and I still think it's worth it. We need to be careful because up close he can do an attack that kills him if it hits us, but it's not the end of the world. I win the fight by trading once again, and they die at the same time as he does, but for the game it's all good and we can get back our souls and proceed. After avoiding the jailers in the Irithyll dungeon, we reach the Profane Capital where we can find Sigvard. Today isn't his lucky day though, because he is holding the weapon that will allow us to defeat Jorm. There is another copy of it in the arena, but that's beside the point. I can, finally, show how to properly defeat him. This sword's weapon art, only against him and only here, becomes a huge gust of wind that staggers him and deals him a huge amount of damage. It doesn't use focus because they want everybody to be able to use it, but it's actually listed as the weapon art in the description of the sword, so there's no doubt that it's the actual weapon art. Jorm falls, and we get teleported to where we should fight the Dancer of the Boreal Valley, but she's already dead, so we can proceed normally. Rip to her, but I'm different. We get back into Lothric Castle, but this time we have to fight the Dragon Slayer armor. I struggled a bit in this fight, mostly because we can be easily punished by its fast shield swings, and its attacks deal a ton of damage. Also, sometimes it decides to raise the shield and we deal no damage, but there are no cheap tricks we can do. We just have to endure the fight, dodge attacks, and maybe try to be a little less greedy than usual, and we can win. Now that the armor is dead, we can create one of the most powerful weapons in the game, that will be with us for the rest of the run. The Dragon Slayer Great Axe. Wait, since when this video was divided in parts? It needs 40 strength though, so we aren't quite ready to unleash its enormous power on unexpected bosses, but it will happen soon enough. In the meantime, we make a quick trip to the Irithyll dungeon to get some ashes that allow us to buy unlimited gold pine resin, and from there we venture into the Consumed King's Garden, where we can fight Osiris, the Consumed King. The guy who owns the garden, I guess? Also, who named it like that? Why insult the guy while naming the place?
Oh yes, and over there are the fat Prime Minister Woods.
Like, come on! Anyway, this fight is pretty janky. He sometimes charges at us, sometimes against the wall, a lot of times he decides to spin in place and hitboxes are really unreliable. But thankfully, it isn't that hard. We want to be just behind his hinder legs, so that we can roll under his belly to dodge some swipes and we can attack him easily when he decides to repeatedly swipe in our general direction. The lightning raising helps us a bit, but he is meant to be tanky, so the fight still takes a long time. We managed to take the dragon down first try, and we can proceed. Our next step is through the Untended Graves, where we can fight Champion Gundyr. And if any longtime fan is wondering about my graphics card health, this time there are no stretched polygons, so let's hope for the best. Now, I messed up a bit here, meaning I actually lost the footage of the fight with Gundyr. So I reloaded a backup save and got back here to show you the fight. There might be a couple of discrepancies between this fight and the rest of the video because I rushed here to waste less time. I hope it's not a problem, but I lost the footage, so there isn't much I can do. After the fight, I will obviously be playing with the normal save file. This one you're seeing now is just for the fight. Also, like, the boss is easy, his attacks are slow, and we did a ton of damage, so defeating him is not a problem. From there, we make a quick stop to take the eyes of a firekeeper, and then we go to the Grand Archives. This area is a bit harder than the previous ones, mostly because of the tight corridors where we are almost forced to fight enemies, but nothing we can't handle. After killing the three NPCs outside, that are just chilling in the sun waiting for someone to challenge them, we can run up some stairs and fight the Twin Princes. This fight is notoriously hard in these challenges, because our attacks are really slow and they can punish us easily. That said, in this case, it was a bit easier than usual. Thanks to the resin, we deal a good amount of damage. If we play aggressively, we can end up trading hits, because our attacks are slow and we can hit him and then dodge only against some of his follow-up moves, but it's not that bad. We have enough poise so we aren't interrupted when we get hit mid-attack, and we defeat the first phase. Here, if we kill the boss while we are behind a pillar or directly behind her back, we can heal up and buff easily, since they don't see us. I don't think it's a glitch, but I'm not that sure about it. Phase 2 is harder, but not by a lot. We have to hit them in a specific location though, because if we only attack the older brother, we can only get a couple of hits on the younger one, since our attacks are that slow. But if we aim to the side of both brothers, we can reliably hit both of them with one attack, meaning that we virtually deal double damage. And it's a pretty easy spot to hit after we dodge their attacks, definitely faster than having to run around them and attack in the back, even though it can be a bit more risky. With this technique, and maybe a couple of trials, the princes fall to the ground, defeated. We burn the cinders of the lords and we travel to the kiln of the first flame, but now we have to do all the additional content before fighting the Soul of Cinder. At first I did a short trip to the drag heap, just to get some souls and unlock the bonfire to the first boss, but then I decided to proceed with some kind of logic and I went to Archdragon Peak. Here we have to defeat the ancient wyvern that you are supposed to kill with a plunging attack to the head. Someone may be okay with that, but in my book, since it isn't a weapon art, it's not allowed. That is why we now introduce another weapon in this run, the composite bow, whose weapon art allows you to rapid fire arrows to the enemy. there is basically no waiting time between them, and it only costs a couple points of focus, so you only have to stop to regain stamina. If we attack this boss in the talons, we basically deal no damage, so I decided that aiming for his head was a good idea. The thing is, we still did basically no damage, so I went and bought poison arrows from Batches and got ready to wait a very long time. Now the only thing you have to do is hit the wyvern with enough arrows, around 30, to poison it, then wait for the poison to end, and poison it again. Meanwhile, the boss will try and walk towards me to burn me up. We can go inside the structure to avoid the flames, but the fight took so long that the wyvern got basically inside the building and could hit me, so I had to run back and forth a bit to avoid being hit. Nothing very hard to do though. I know this looks cheesy, but the fight is really, really bad because you aren't supposed to beat it like this. It's a gimmick, so it works poorly as soon as you step out of the defined boundaries. That said, I didn't use glitches or exploits, the boss isn't immune to poison unlike most of them, so I think it's a fair thing to do, even if it's boring. I ran out of poisoned arrows after 3 cycles, so I had to get out and finish the fight with regular arrows. I got thrown around by the phantom hitboxes a bit, but it's fine. And after something like half an hour, I won, and we can proceed. After a quick stroll in the ruins, we ring the bell in order to fight the Nameless King, but now we are strong enough to wield the Dragon's Lair Greataxe. And wouldn't you know it, we are going to fight a dragon. The first phase can be quite annoying, because he can decide to fly around and there isn't much we can do about it. Thankfully though, we deal a disgusting amount of damage to him, so it's pretty easy. This weapon art does lightning damage in a circle and the dragon is weak to it, but we still have to hit with the main body of the axe to unleash its true damage potential. Now it's time for phase 2, the actual fight. Our attack animation is very long, so we end up getting hit after hitting the boss a lot of times. But at the end of our attack we have our back lowered, and this means that these wipes will miss us almost every time, as they are just a tiny bit above us. I didn't think the game was so well made, but in this case we have to give credit where credit is due. Thanks Miyazaki. Our weapon is heavy, and this means that after some hits we can stagger the boss. Remember, we aren't allowed to riposte him since it isn't a weapon art, but while he's staggered he will take extra damage from all attacks, so we get something out of it. With one last axe slam we topple the king, and now only the DLCs remain. First in line is the champion's grave tender and his wolf. I'd ask all PETA employees to please look away. The first part of the fight is pretty easy, we can spam attacks and we will kill the little wolves with the splash damage, while the champion will be pushed around and staggered most of the time. Still, we have to be sure that we have him killed before the wolf joins the fight, or we are pretty much toast. Against the wolf, we can be near a wall, so when it attacks us, it will not run past us and instead simply stop against the wall. We kill it in 4 hits, so it's not hard at all, and we can proceed. We have to run on some roofs in the Corvian settlement, and then we need to fight Sir Vilheim. He is strong, but he's still a humanoid, so if we get one clear hit on him, he'll fall to the ground, and this pretty much seals his fate. From there, we have to run in the snowy field, kick down some trees, activate a contraption, and we can tackle the last boss fight of this DLC, Sister Fride and Father Ariandel. This fight is usually considered tough, and we can't backstab her, but this weapon trivializes it. The weapon art will knock her to the ground, so we simply have to wait for her to jump and become invisible, get near her before she attacks, and spam it. As long as we have stamina and we manage to attack as soon as the previous attack ends, she shouldn't be able to run away, so we can simply dodge her attacks until she jumps twice, and she will die. Phase 2 can be a bit harder, we have to focus Ariandel since he takes more damage and he is a huge target, but we have to keep an eye out for Frida's ranged attacks. She may decide to become invisible and yell, and this time it isn't a guaranteed kill because Ariandel may interrupt us, but still, we have to hit them 5 times total, it shouldn't be a problem. Phase 3 is similar to the first one. She has a couple more openings where we can hit her, but she is more aggressive and is more damage, and remember that every time we push her down we can hit her as long as we have stamina. Our main opening is still the dash and invisibility attack, but this time she won't only stay still charging a grab. At first she will try to hit us with ranged attacks, but after some time she will start charging and that's when we strike. I think she may dash away when she's on the floor on this phase, but it shouldn't be a problem since we only have to hit her 5 or 6 times. With unexpected ease, the fight ends. We already unlocked the last bonfire in Drag Heap, so we go straight to fighting the demons. This boss is really weak to bleed, and they tried doing some build around it but it didn't have much success, so we'll stick to the Greataxe. In the first phase, the bosses will alternate being a melee one and a ranged one. We want to attack whoever is melee, because the ranged attacks are easy to dodge, and we can reliably go near the other one and attack freely. Most of the time we have to avoid being hit by the first attack, and the following us will miss us. We have to repeat it with both enemies, and I usually kill the demon in pain first, because I know better that version of the Demon Prince. But I'm not sure it's the best choice. After the two demons, we have to fight the Demon Prince. He has many attacks that allow us to hit him after dodging, but he is resistant to lightning and has a lot of HP, so it will take a while. When he flies away from us, trying to knock us down with the wings, is when he will do his laser attack. Recognizing this pattern will allow us to hit him at least a couple of times, but there isn't much strategy in this fight. We have to know which attacks are slow and properly dodge them. I ended up staggering him twice in this fight, and each time it's some nice free damage. After almost running out of resources, I got the last hit in, and now we can fly to the Ringed City, to face the hardest challenges in the game. Here we have to dodge some arrows, run down some stairs, avoid being hit by huge swords, and make our way in a swamp. But we don't have to fight anyone, so it's not a big deal. We reach Midir's Bridge, where we can either tank the flames or dodge them. I honestly never understood if there are safe places here or simply a good dodge works, but we make it to the other side regardless. And after getting lost in some ruins, we have to fight him for the first time. I was dreading this fight, but it wasn't that bad. We can attack his talons and still deal a good amount of damage. When he is spewing fire, we can attack him freely, and after that he will try to burn the section of the bridge where he is standing. So we can run back and forth triggering attacks and dealing 3 damage until he will put down his head and then finish him. Now we have unlocked his actual boss fight, but it's not time to fight him yet. We proceed straight ahead, and after entering a church, we are ready for the next boss. With a couple of hits, we take down Judicator Argo, then we have to fight Half-Light. He deals an insane amount of damage. He can block our hits, and is fast enough to retaliate between our attacks when we knock him down. But we kill him in 5 direct hits, and we can poise through his attacks, so he can't do much against us. Half-Light done, only 3 bosses remain. We touch Filianor's Shell, and we can fight Slave Nightgale. He's weak to poison, so I tried some hybrid build using the composite bow to poison him, but I think it's not worth it, and once again, we have to rely on the Great Axe. Not that I'm complaining. In the first phase, we can stagger him easily if we hit him when he isn't attacking, so the strategy is to dodge toward his back and attack him. If he's doing a follow-up attack, he'll probably miss us. And if he's trying to jump around, we will stop him in his tracks. His attacks are pretty slow, so if we know what we are doing, we can spam our art a bit without having to worry too much. Phase 2 begins, and popping an ember will help us out, since we'll end up trading hits more often now. He has sequences of 2 to 4 attacks, so you can be super safe and always assume 4 and dodge them all, or you can bet a little and worst case scenario you'll trade a hit. Doing it is risky, but speeds up the fight a lot. As we did against the Nameless King, we can dodge his wipes when we have our back lowered, but it's definitely harder to do here. That said, it still looks sick. His charge attacks and jumps are a good way to get 3 damage in, and the third phase begins. Now he is more aggressive and attacks faster, so trading some hits is bound to happen. If the cape hits us and we hit him, it's fine. We want to avoid the sword. We can stagger him, but he will be stunned for a very short time, so it's only useful if we know we can stop his next attack. Remember that only the second half of our attack has hyper armor, so if we get too cocky, we can easily be punished. His charges remain a good way to hit him, but he has follow-up attacks now. All in all, he has pretty clear tells, and we deal a good amount of damage, considering this is one of the hardest bosses in the game. So after some sweat, we hit him one last time, and only 2 bosses remain. We have to fight Midir, by far the hardest boss in the game, and we can't even riposte him. I wasn't sure on how to edit this part, but the fight is pretty epic, and Evangelion 3.0 plus 1.01 is coming out in a month, and that's when the inspiration struck. There will be flashing lights, I don't think it's going to be a problem, but just to be sure. Also, like, the strategy is to hit him in the head and dodge the attacks, forehead. Thank you. Now that the Dragon Slayer Great Axe was actually used to slay a dragon, we can fight the final boss of the game. The Soul of Cinder isn't a hard fight, compared to Gale, Midir or even Frida, and we are way overleveled and over-equipped now. But stay till the end because we're going to have a secret ending to complete the tetralogy. We deal a lot of damage, so training hits is a viable strategy and the fight shortly ends. Now we can finish the game, but we already did the 3 endings in the 3 previous videos. Well, turns out there is a 4th, secret one. After summoning the Firekeeper, in between the cutscenes, we briefly have control of our character, and here, with a weapon art, we can attack her. We have the special ending, and while we watch it, I can say that you can beat the Dark Souls 3 with only weapon art. If you did the challenge yourselves, let me know in the comments, and if you enjoyed the video, leave a like or even subscribe. I'll see you next time. Well, you'll see me. See the video at least. Why do you always mess up the outro?